Go on, man. We're not 1 and 2. Let's go out here and play this thing, all right?
Let's be ready to roll on now.
I like that.
What time is it?
Game time!
Boom! Welcome to another episode of Game Time. My name's Mike. I'm here, as always, with Dave and Jeff. And today we've got one of the finest hoopers in the Philippines, Miss Bea Daez Fabros. Bea, thank you so much for taking some time out of your busy schedule to join us today.
Yes, thank you also for inviting me. I'm excited.
Yeah, first of all, congratulations on our behalf. You're a new mom.
Yes.
How's motherhood treating you?
How's motherhood treating me? Well, I think it's been 3 months already, so I think I've sort of got the hang of it already. Well, I don't want to speak too soon because I know that she changes every week, almost every day. But you know, it's been a roller coaster ride. I've had my ups and downs as well. It's a very big change for me, but I'm super happy, super fulfilling to see her grow up. Every day she's changing, and you know, she's learning how to communicate with us also now that she's already almost 3 months. So, ang sarap na may baby in the time of COVID kasi, syempre, we're just here in the house. So, at least may nakakaaliw, just look at her. And then you'll have a big smile on your face already. So, yeah, I'm really happy to have this experience with Lucia, my baby.
Right, right. Speaking of having a kid, usually we ask our guests what their routine is like before COVID and during COVID, but I'll ask you instead, what was it like before you had your baby? What was the schedule like compared to, obviously now it's a bit different with COVID and
we were
stuck in the house and all that, but what before the kid, before COVID and everything, what was it like for you? What was the regular schedule like?
Okay, well, we can backtrack to like when I wasn't pregnant yet, because I was actually part of the national team last year.
Yeah.
So my schedule back then was really crazy. So I'd actually wake up at around 5 a.m., 5:30 in the morning so that I can get a workout in the morning at around 6 a.m. Mm. So I'd shoot at UP or I'd lift weights, have conditioning. And then after I'd go to work at around 8:30 a.m. and then that's all up until 5 p.m. And then at 5 p.m. from BGC, I'll go back to Quezon City for our 7 p.m. training. So usually, I'm like right on time sa sobrang traffic sa EDSA. And then I have to zone out and throw away all my work, everything that's on my mind, and just zone into the training. And then that's 7 to 9 p.m. And then I get home at around 10, 10:30, and then repeat every day. So yeah, that was really crazy, but I wouldn't change a thing. I love basketball so much, so it was worth it. It's okay.
That's what's up. We love basketball too much sometimes, I think, for our own good here.
Yeah.
As well on the show. Speaking of basketball, we're gonna talk about hoops a lot in this episode. Obviously, we know you from basketball, from your stint as a player, and also from your stint as a commentator during games. But outside of basketball, outside of hoops, what else are you into?
Well, my husband really loves to travel, so I've fallen in love with traveling as well. Mm-hmm. But of course, now in the time of COVID now, so everything's on a halt in terms of traveling, but aside from that, I really love dancing. So I actually I'm a dancer ever since I was in high school. I was a gymnast also. So I love to do that too. Thankfully, in our company where I work, every Christmas, there's like a big dance competition. So I usually join that. So
nice.
At least, kahit papano, still fit, still staying fit. So yeah.
what kind of dance are we talking about?
Hip hop. Real nice. Hip hop.
Right, right. Cool. And in terms of traveling, any favorite places that you've visited?
Well, I love the Philippines because I really love going to the beach.
Mm.
But in terms of where we've been to so far, I think the best place that I've been to so far would be Amsterdam. I was able to go there last year. So, sobrang ganda and I really want to go back hopefully.
Yeah, hopefully when everything is back to somewhat normal, I guess.
Yeah.
Yeah. Dave, do you want to... Oh, sorry, Jeff, you have a question.
Yeah. So, in Amsterdam, what specific place or what specific experience stood out for you the most?
Well, for me there, I just loved how diverse everyone is. The food, sobrang sarap talaga, and the weather is really nice. I think it's just completely different from Manila. There were a lot of things that we weren't able to do, like we weren't really able to go to a lot of museums since we were only there for 2 days. So parang sobrang nabitin ako. So I just hope that I'll have more time next time to go back.
Right. Have you ever been to Australia?
Not yet.
Yeah, you should come and visit. Like, if you like the beaches here are like...
Yeah, actually, our next
on point
destination was supposed to be Australia next year. So if the travel ban is lifted next year, hopefully.
Yeah, I think I heard they're looking at about mid-2021 in allowing foreign visitors again back to the country. But yeah, fingers crossed everything works out for... Not just for us, but for the rest of the world, I guess.
Yeah.
Dave, do you want to take it to our quick hits segment?
Sure. I thought you were going to ask about the Jutes in Amsterdam. Dina.
Dina. off the air.
Okay. Thanks, Mike. Bea, the next segment we call Quick Hits, basically it's a almost like word association. Some of our guests on the show, they like to provide more context. They like to explain. Some of them just want to go as quickly as possible. Depends on how you want to do it. But okay. Basically, I say a word, a place, a name, or a concept. And the only rule is the first thing that comes to mind, you say it as fast and as quick as you can. Sounds good?
Okay, nakakaba naman. Okay, game.
Okay, again. Should be good. Like number one on my list, CHK.
CHK. Basketball. Varsity teams. Yan. Kailangan ganun ba? Or payang kwento?
Up to you. Totally. That works too. That works
okay
too.
Okay.
Yeah, unless you want to point out something specific that you remember, that's fine as well that you want to share. So if it's just one word or a phrase, that's perfectly fine.
Okay.
Okay. Right. Practice.
Practice. Waking up early in the morning. Ganun talaga, puyatan, pero okay lang.
What was that your schedule even with the UP women's team?
For UP, I would wake up at 4:30 all the time because we have to be in UP by around 5:30 a.m. So
man,
for 5 years, ganun talaga. That's why when I joined the national team again last year, it wasn't really much of a difference for me. I actually felt like I was back in college in a sense. So going to work was sort of like going to school. It's just that I had to train in the morning on my own, and then at nighttime was the real training. So yun lang yung difference niya.
Right. Okay. What about Kobe?
Kobe. Idol. Yan. Idol ko talaga si Kobe. So I really love the Lakers actually.
Mike is happy. You see Mike smile. Kinikilig na yan inside there.
Interestingly enough though, I'm more of like a Philippine basketball fan than an NBA fan. So I watch more of like the PBA, UAAP, PBL, mga MPBL, mga ganun. So that's actually more of what I would watch more than the NBA. I sort of stopped when I was in college. I only watched NBA, like really followed it when I was in high school. So, yeah, I guess I was too busy to watch NBA pa.
Interesting. Okay. Next on my list, China.
China? Parang si Duterte yung naaalala ko. Hindi ko alam kung bakit. Tsaka yun. Next topic.
Next topic, accounting.
Accounting. Oh my gosh. Iyakan days. So even if I'm a CPA, oh my gosh, it was such a crazy experience trying to get that, you know, CPA after my name. So I took up business administration and accountancy when I was in UP. It was a 5-year course. and our exams for accounting would be around 10 hours long, 8 hours long straight. Yeah, so it was really crazy. And sometimes when I look back, I wonder how I was able to get through everything, even with basketball and all. But I'm just happy it's all over.
Wow, 10 hours.
Yeah, it's crazy. Sometimes siguro mga 2 hours doon, medyo nakatunga nga lang ako. Di ko na alam kung ano sasagot ko.
All right. Never. Okay. Sunken Garden.
Sunken Garden. UP Fair. Well, for me, I never really went to the Sunken Garden. In UP, my life was really just UPCBA, which is our college. And UPCHK, the gym. That's it. Back and forth. I didn't really have much time, or if I did, I would rather like take a rest or study. So I was really busy in college with accounting and basketball, so I didn't really have much time to, you know, go around.
That sounds like a perfectly good day to me, though.
Talaga.
Yeah, basketball, and I mean, I like business, so.
Okay.
What about fake news?
Fake news. Siguro nakakainis. Yun lang masasabi ko. Yeah, we have to be able to filter all the fake news properly. Don't just read the headlines. Sometimes I'm also a victim of that, just reading the headlines. You have to be able to click the article and read the whole article fully before you judge. Because we never know what false judgments we can create, and it might create a stir in media, and we all know that all of us are so much dependent on what we see in social media now, so we have to stay informed and stay knowledgeable so that we don't spread fake news. Yeah.
2-3 zone.
2-3 zone. I choose man-to-man over 2-3 zone. I personally love going man-to-man. Except, of course, it depends on the tactics of the coach. Siyempre, kapag malaki yung big man sa ilalim, siyempre, 2-3 zone na lang minsan, diba? So, to clog the paint. So, naging ano na tayo? Tactical. But then yun, I choose man-to-man over 2-3 zone any day.
Same. It's amazing to me. I'm not sure if you find the same experience, but when I'm playing with... imports, the general tendency is to play man.
Yeah.
But if it's a Pinoy pickup game, usually naka dos tres.
Oh, tamad na tamad.
Okay. Pick and roll offense.
Pick and roll offense. I love having pick and rolls. I'm usually the point guard, so I usually love asking for a pick and roll. There are so many things that you can do with the pick and roll. Sometimes people just think that, you know, it can be an isolation game, but it's actually not. It can lead up to so many other options with a simple pick and roll. You just have to be able to practice all the possible options. So, yeah.
Mike, you had a question?
No. I'm okay, man. Keep on going.
All right.
Yeah.
Next item, democracy.
Wow, may ganon. Democracy. Well, right now I think that hindi ko in-expect yung ganon, babe, na questions. Okay, I think right now
that's the usual reaction we get, by the way. Sorry.
Nabigla ako. Okay. At the height of the pandemic and all the issues that we're having, I think our freedom of speech and expression is so much important right now, and we need to be able to have a voice, especially with all the problems that we're all encountering. And hopefully the government will allow all of us to be able to raise our sentiments, because in a democratic country, we all have the right to be heard.
Yeah, she said she didn't prepare for it. So, ang galing, no? Parang right off the bat. Yeah. So, I guess you'll see this one coming. The next name on my list, Rodrigo Duterte.
Oh my gosh. Totoo? Rodrigo Duterte talaga. No comment. No, Well, I wish that the president would really, you know, I know that he's really working hard. I hope that, ano ba? Ang hirap. Ang hirap din. Pass pa ding pass.
No, that's perfectly fine. Sorry, natawa kasi ako when you said he's working hard, but I'm sorry.
He's
anyway.
Working hard. Di ko alam. I'm trying to be positive, di ba? Di ba dapat positive tayo? So,
I like that. Ano. Sige.
Good vibes lang.
Okay. Yeah, tama. Sige.
Pass! Pinawisan na ako.
last item for my quick hits segment, Bea. UP.
UP. You know, to be honest, UP was not my first choice. But I've learned to love UP so much. And I would not have it any other way. It might preempt maybe your next questions later, but then my ride and life in UP was really, really like crazy. It had its ups and downs, but at the end of the day, it really made me who I am now. So I'm really happy that I still chose UP as my college of choice.
All right. Before I go into the X's or O segment, what college was your first choice, Bea?
I see, correct. No, it's okay. Ateneo. But it's
because... Oh, God, we missed out.
It's because all my brothers... it's because all my brothers went to Ateneo. And my mom is from Ateneo. My dad is from Ateneo. But my sister, my older sister, went to UP. So she was one of the... main reasons why I chose to go to UP instead.
Damn, we missed out, man. We missed out, bro.
Yeah, no, we definitely did. but we'll get to that in the later segment. But for our X's or O's segment, Bea, basically I give you two options. The game is you choose which one you prefer, or in some instances, which one you dislike less. So basically, which one is better for you in the two options?
Okay.
All right. Okay. So why don't we start with you mentioned this earlier, swimming or hiking?
Swimming.
Sleeping in or working out?
Working out.
Staying up late or waking up early?
Waking up early. Lola. Sorry. Okay.
I guess I know how you'll answer this one. The next one. Tequila or teka muna?
Teka muna.
Kobe or LeBron?
Kobe.
Scoring or passing?
Scoring.
First five or off the bench?
First five.
Tequila or scotch?
Tequila.
Ice cream or cake?
Ice cream.
Coffee or soda?
Coffee.
Indoor or outdoor?
Indoor.
Isolation or motion offense?
Motion offense.
Organized hoops or street ball?
Organized hoops.
Down one, 10 seconds to go. Do you call timeout or do you want to play on?
Play on.
All right. The next segment, Bea, we call fill in the blanks. I guess as you can infer from the name, basically I say a phrase and you just fill in the blank that makes the sentence, I guess, as true and as accurate as it is for you.
Okay.
So for example, the first on my list, I am happiest when I blank.
I am happiest when I'm with my baby.
Okay, sorry for taking time away from your happiness. Next item, when I play basketball, I blank.
When I play basketball, I am super happy also.
One thing I would like to change about myself is?
Nothing. You should be happy with your own self.
I love that answer. The West Philippine Sea is blank.
Ours.
Last for me, if I had $10 billion today, I would
travel around the world. If puede.
Perfect.
Kung puede.
Perfect. All right. Thank you, Abea, for being game to do all of that. Now we go into the, I guess, the beginning of your hoops career. Mike, why don't you take this one away, bro?
Yeah, so let's start from the, I guess, the beginning for you. What got you into hoops, Bea? How did it all start for you?
Yeah, I actually grew up with seven siblings, seven brothers rather, because we're nine in the family, nine kids. So seven of them are boys, and we had a basketball court outside our house growing up. So I guess just because of the environment I was in and the people around me, basketball just really came to me innately. And aside from that, my mom was an avid Ateneo fan, and she would bring me to all the UAAP games. So I would actually skip school and be absent so that I can watch some of the games of Ateneo in Araneta Coliseum. I would really remember that. And because of that, I just really loved basketball so much since I was a kid. I would join Ateneo Basketball School. Back then, I was the only girl. So I was always the only girl, even playing basketball at home. But for some reason, I just loved it so much. I would watch all the kinds of basketball games I would catch on TV, as in PBL, UAAP, TBA, NBA pa nga, naalala ko yun. I would even watch that.
Yeah.
And I would actually watch PBL live too. So PBA live also during the finals. So because of that, I was like breathing basketball all the time. And I just loved it so much. And because of that, from grade school, high school, college, and even after, nagtuloy-tuloy na lahat.
Right. Before I actually I think Jeff and Dave has a question. Are you the best hooper in the family?
I think so. because I remember my mom, I mean, in terms of playing basketball to our fullest potential, only because I was the only one who continued till college. I mean, my other brothers, I really think that they were good too. I think I have like around two brothers who I think would have been able to play till college if they took it seriously in high school. But then after high school, you know, they eventually didn't want to play competitively anymore, so they all stopped. So I was the only one who ended up playing in the UAAP. Then I was the girl, and you know, women's UAAP was never really televised, except for the finals. So yeah, I'm a bit sad also that none of them continued to play. I always wanted to watch one of my brothers on TV too.
Yeah, well, you're the only one who made it to the national team, so I guess that's fair. Jeff, I'll start with you. What's your question?
All right, Bea. So you mentioned about your seven brothers. I'm curious, actually, what personality trait or what quality they had that probably shaped you on who you are as an athlete right now?
I think all of us in our family is super competitive. And I think that's something that I was able to get from them. I would remember when I was younger in grade school, I would always play one-on-one with my two brothers. I have so many of them, but then yeah, I would play with two of my brothers specifically because they were the same height as me or just a little bit shorter or taller, and we would always end up, one of us would always end up crying and going to my mom and saying madaya or foul nang foul, wala namang foul, ganyan. So that competitive fire from all of us, I think that's something that stuck to me till I got older, and I brought it to every team that I was a part of.
Cool. Before I give it to Dave, just a quick question. What's your favorite PBA or NBA team growing up?
PBA team growing up, I really loved Talk and Text, because I love Jimmy Alapag and Jason Castro specifically. For the NBA, when I was a really big fan of the NBA, it was really the time of Shaquille O'Neal and Kobe Bryant. Mm. So the Lakers talaga, and their rivalry with the San Antonio Spurs. I would love watching that series between the both of them in the Western Conference Finals. So yeah.
That's interesting because actually Dave is a San Antonio Spurs fan, while Mike here is a Lakers fan. All right, over to you, Dave.
Yeah, thanks, Jeff. Actually, I had two questions. The other one Mike already asked, which was are you the best hooper in the family? The second one is, I'm just curious to find out, Bea, how come your mom, I guess, what was the story behind her becoming a huge hoops fan? If you're okay to share.
Yeah, sure. Well, my mom's family, they're all very athletic as well. And all of her siblings are either track and field players or basketball players also in Ateneo. So I'm from a family of Ateneans, both in my mom's side and my dad's side. So I guess because of that, she would always watch their games. So even when she had her own kids, she would still watch the UAAP. And I guess with me and my sister, I'm the one who really fell in love with basketball. So I would go with her all the time. And yeah, she basically also made me fall in love with basketball aside from my brothers.
All right. Thank you. Mike?
Right. You mentioned you came from a basketball family. Talk about your high school. Talk about your high school basketball career, I guess, and how that started for you. What was it like? And how did it work for you? Like, how was tryouts like? Were you a starter straight away? Were you a star player straight away? Or how did that whole thing work?
Okay, so I started when I was in college, in grade school actually. So grade 4, I was already part of the basketball team. And during that time, there were just a few basketball players in grade school and we couldn't really make a team. Sometimes we would just be around 7 players in a team. So when I was in grade 7 actually, the high school team asked me to join them. So when I was in grade 7, I was playing for the high school team in one league. And then after that, in high school, in my school, there aren't a lot of basketball players in my batch. Actually, in my batch, we were only 2. And we were only 2 on my last year. So from first year to third year high school, I was the only one from my batch in basketball. But I guess that's how much I love the sport. I didn't mind if I was with other people from different batches. And I think that with that, it just really made me fall in love with the sport even more because I got to know different people and all. But yeah, in high school, we were able to win the championship on my third year for WBL. And then, but back then, my mindset was more of just like, I want to play college ball. I want to play college ball because it was going to be the UAAP already. And I was trying to eye what school I wanted to go to. So, yeah.
Right. How was it like, man, as a seventh grader playing in the high school team? How was that experience? Like, you must have been really good. I can't relate. So how, like, tell me about that a little bit. I'm curious.
Yeah. Well, actually, when I was in grade school, when I would see all my ates in high school in the basketball team, a lot of them actually played in college basketball. I think there were more female ballers in my school who were older than me than in my batch and closer to my batch. So I really wanted to play with them. And actually, one of my greatest moments when I look back would actually be that time when I was in grade 7 and playing with all my ates because I really learned a lot from them. Kasi nga, I think during my time when I was in high school, there weren't that many female basketball players in my school particularly. So it was a good experience. I really had fun during that time. Yeah.
Okay. So now when it's time to go to college, it's time to choose which school you were gonna go to. Can you talk us a little bit through that process and how did UP become the top choice and not Ateneo, unfortunately?
Oh my gosh. Okay. This is the first time that I'm actually going to talk about this. But when I was in grade 7, yeah, when I was in grade 7, I actually trained with the Ateneo College team already around 5 times during the summer.
Oh my goodness.
And I was like so sure, just because I was so sure that I was going to go to Ateneo, because there was no other choice for me back then. Oh my gosh, maybe I have some UP teammates who are watching, but they all know about this, so it's okay. But basically, I was so sure that I was going to Ateneo. But for some reason, I don't know, I guess I wanted something different from the high school that I was in. I went to Assumption. And I felt like I wanted to go out of the box because I felt like we were so enclosed back in high school. And I felt that UP was going to be able to give me, you know, that freedom to be able to explore so many other things and all. And I felt like maybe Ateneo was going to be the same. I wasn't sure and all. So I just wanted something so different from my comfort zone. And my sister, being from Assumption as well, told me that UP would be able to give me that. So I was just like, okay, last minute, I actually trained with Ateneo when I graduated college, graduated high school one time. And then after, I was like, I'm so sorry. I think I'll be choosing UP. So there. But no regrets, of course. I really enjoyed my stint in UP. During my first year, I think I was super culture shocked, to be honest. I was doubting already, like, if I made the right decision, or I was like, should I go back to my first choice or what? But I stuck to my decision, and I'm happy that I stayed. So yeah.
So not only did you play in high as a grade 7 kid in high with high school girls, you also trained with the Ateneo College team at that time.
Yeah, wow, just for a few times though. Yeah,
I mean, but still though, like that's a huge step. Like, that's amazing.
Grabe,
like,
no? Parang may LeBron, di ba?
Yeah, man, that's no, I mean, that's next level for me, in my eyes at least. But how was the experience for playing in UP? What was, you mentioned you had culture shock at the beginning. How did you adjust to that? And how quick did you adjust to it?
Yeah, I guess I had culture shock not from my teammates, but just with the culture of UP as a whole. Just because, you know, the campus is so big, your classrooms, sometimes you have to take Jeep to go from one classroom to another. It was hard to make friends, just because in every class, you never had the same classmate every class that you had. But I really drew a lot of strength from my teammates. I wasn't classmates with any of them my first year. But in my second year, I joined one org. And then I would try to spend more time with my teammates during my breaks. Just so that, you know, I would have like a sense of like that classroom setting and having your friends with you all the time. So that really helped me go by. But eventually I really learned to love the school, learned to love the campus and everything. So yeah.
Right. Dave, you had a question?
Yeah, I was gonna ask Bea about her time at Assumption. In the previous episode, Cassie Choseco mentioned that yeah, yun nga, pagka umuulan daw, tapos humangin, wala nang ensayo kasi mababasado yung court. How different was your experience from her during your time there? Ganun pa rin ba na?
Hindi na. Kasi there was a sports complex that was built during my time already. So, hindi na namin masyadong abutan yung pag-umuulan. Ano. But I did experience that in UP. So, grabe. As in, konting ulan lang, may parang puddle of water na. So, sometimes there's a pail.
And then the we CHK.
Put it there. The CHK, yes. So, we put a pail there. So, parang kaming nagpapatentero. So, bawal tumapak sa malapit sa pail or else you'll get injured, you'll slip and all. So, Kakaibang experience right. Sa UP.
Right. And the other question that I had, Bea, you mentioned that you wanted to go to UP somewhat or maybe to, I guess, get a different experience from your high school, I guess, circle of friends. Was it, I guess, did it live up to your expectations in terms of how, or I guess, how did it, I guess, widen your perspective, your horizon as a young adult?
Well, one thing that I really experienced from UP would be the independent living. You know, you have so much freedom to choose to go to class, to choose not to go to class, do whatever you want, but it's up to you to remain disciplined in knowing what your goals are, knowing what your priorities are. And I'm just thankful that I think I was able to set my priorities straight and, you know, not get distracted by the many other things that I could have done, like, you know, cut class or anything. But yeah, I think I was able to really learn to have a strong mind and learn how to be disciplined, especially with my time management with school and basketball. Yeah.
Right. Jeff, you have a question?
Yep. Bea, you mentioned about the rigorous activities that you had on UP back then. I think you mentioned something like you woke up at around 4:30 a.m. every day, and you.
Yeah.
I don't know how the activity was then up to what time. But I'm actually curious. What was there a memorable experience on you balancing out with studies and being a Lady Maroon as well? Like, was there a big game, then you also had exams after, something like that?
Oh, yeah. There are a lot of times that right after the game, I would go straight to class. There were a lot of times that during breaks during our class, I would just be in the library, sleep, or sometimes if I had the car, I'd go to my car and sleep. Just so that I could get that, you know, 30 minutes of rest and all, because grabe yung puyatan to be able to study for that accounting exam. And then our trainings talagang every day talaga, sometimes even Sundays. There were a lot of family vacations that you had to say no to and all. A lot of late night outs that I never really got to join with my friends from high school. So it really took a lot of discipline. So I can't really say one specific experience, but as a whole, it really took a lot of dedication. But I'm just happy because I loved what I was doing so much in terms of basketball. And so it made everything worth it, waking up early in the morning. Yeah.
Right. Thanks for that, Bea.
Forgive me for asking this, but and I guess this is one of the things we're going to cover in a little bit. But for me, I personally didn't get to see much or hear much if at all of your career back in UP, and that's because unfortunately we don't have as much coverage of the women's game as we do for the men's. But can you maybe talk us through a bit of some of the, I guess, highlights of your time at UP, memorable games, memorable experiences, you know, teammates, coaches, anything like that?
Mm-hmm. Okay, so the reason why I said that UP really has made me who I am is because I've really experienced one of the hardest times of my life in UP. And I say that because in my fourth year, and I was the team captain for back then, we actually had a 0-14 record. So that was really hard for me as the leader of the pack. And it's hard for me because I feel like I take responsibility for that. Of course, it's like a team thing. But as the captain, I feel like I had more responsibility for that. And it taught me so much in terms of how to become a leader and how to become a better teammate on how to become a better player. And going into my final year in UP, I was thinking I would never want to leave this school on a losing end. Mm. And the only thing that I'd want to leave as a legacy would to bring back the winning culture of UP. Because during that time, talunan na nga yung men's. Biglang talunan na din yung women's. And it was never like that in UP for the women's team, at least. So I really had to assess everything. As in, it wasn't really about my skills anymore. It was more about the mental game. Like, how am I going to be able to make these younger players, my younger teammates, unite as one, as the eldest of the team and as the leader of the team. And actually, my best friend and my teammate quit the team on her fifth year because we were 0-14 the previous year. So I really felt alone at that time, and I really had to garner up so much strength just to be able to, you know, bounce back on my last year. But thankfully, on my last year, we actually had we had four straight wins to end the season. So we stopped the losing streak, and I'm happy that we were able to end the season on a winning note. And whenever people ask me like what was the hardest time, I always say that because I really feel like it changed me so much. And the learnings really go beyond the basketball court. Gabi, pag, as in, whatever problem I go through now, I always just think of that time because I really feel like I was a completely different person on my last year compared to the season prior to that. Yeah.
How did you do it? How did you, I guess, change that mindset for you personally, coming from a 0-14 season and then going to the next year, losing your, you know, like you mentioned, your best friend, your teammate on the team, you felt really alone. How did that mindset change for you?
So, during the summer before my final season, I joined the national team. I actually tried out, and I joined the team, and I was part of the pool. And then I was hoping to make the SEA Games in 2015, but then I ended up being a reserve. So for the SEA Games in 2015. So at that time, I think it was a humbling experience for me. Actually, it really was a humbling experience for me that, you know, after always being, you know, in the starting five and everything, now you're back to square one. You're in a team and you're not the star player. Everyone is good. You learn how to become a real teammate to everyone. You have to treat everyone the same way and everything. So I guess that really helped me, you know, help my mind. Then my mindset, have the right mindset in treating everyone, and that humbling experience made me, you know, a better person, and share it also to my team. Na parang, you know, you have to be able to understand where everyone is coming from, and I just tried to use that experience to, you know, become a better teammate to all my other teammates in UP. And I think that when I went back, I was a better player, and I also was a better leader and a better teammate. And from that, I think that I actually felt that, you know, our relationship with my team was so much better from the previous season. And I guess it was one of the reasons why we were able to finally win again. So it's really not just about skill. That's what I learned the most. It's really not about skill of the team, because skill-wise, everyone would say na magaling naman yung players ng UP, but then we just couldn't like be one unit cohesively. So with that, that's why I always put into my mind, it's really about the relationship of the whole team together with the coaches as well. So yeah.
Right. Before we talk about your SNA experience, I want to briefly touch on your experience with the national team. When did the dream, I guess, of playing for the national team for you become a reality? Like, I mean, not a reality, but like a reachable reality.
Well, being part of the national team has always been my dream, because I feel like the national team in the Philippines is the highest form of competition because we don't have a professional league. And I really wanted to be part of it because I felt like it would challenge me more to become a better player. When I was in college, I was fortunate enough to be able to be part of the or try out at least for the national team in 2015. But sadly, yun nga, I wasn't part of the roster for the 2015 SEA Games, and I really felt like I could be part. I was like, no, this won't end here, which is why after college, I took the boarding exams and then I started working. I had a day job already, but then Danica Jose, one of my good friends and teammate also in the national team, I was telling her that, you know, we should go back. We can do it one more time. So I'm really happy that I was able to, for one more time last year, to be able to play. So, yeah.
Right, right. At the national team level, what was the biggest adjustment for you playing at that level, and also like competing with these girls, like you mentioned, like everyone's like really good, right? You're not the star anymore. You're not, you know, you're not the hindi ka na sure in the starting five guys. Sometimes, you know, there's different rotations and all that. What was the talk us through that a little bit.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, being part of the national team is like one of the next biggest challenges also for me. Mentally. Grabe yung mental challenge sa'yo eh. Kasi alam mo magaling ka eh. Alam mo din magagaling mga teammates mo. So, in term, it parang labanan na lang sa mindset kung sino yung pinakamatapang, kung sino yung hindi susuko. And I admit that sometimes I would feel inferior to other players kasi ang gagaling din nila eh. Pero in my mind, I would be like, pero alam kong kaya ko din. Alam kong kaya makipagsabayan. But sometimes, your fear comes in first before you thinking that you can do it, and that would eat you up altogether. Sometimes, diba, when you shoot in a game, sabi ng mga coaches na it's all about the confidence na lang, diba? Kasi minsan, nagpa-practice ka naman every day, so it's all about your confidence. You need to be able to be confident in your shot at papasok din yan. So, grabe lang yung mental challenge sobra sa akin sa national team. I think that all my insecurities came out when I was in the national team just because I was so scared. I hate losing. And at the same time, you're teammates with one another, but at the same time, you're fighting for a spot. Mm-hmm. So in that in itself, trying to handle that dynamic of you being friends with everyone, but you challenging yourself to be better, not being able to perform, and thinking that you would lose a chance to make it into the team. You need to be able to really have the balance of everything for you to be able to excel. Yeah. Mm.
The team recently, in the last SEA Games, obviously won gold. What would it take for us to remain at that level consistently and even elevate us to competing with some of the top teams within the Asian region? What do you think would it take for us to, yeah?
Yeah, so actually last year, leading up to the SEA Games, I think that our training program was perfect. Perfectly scheduled, perfectly planned by all our coaches because we started training January pa lang. We went to Taiwan and then we had a training camp there. We had Jones Cup, we had FIBA Asia, then we had the FIBA Asia Qualifying Cup, which led right before the SEA Games. So every day, we always had training. We had pocket tournaments in between, and basically, what I'm saying is that we need to be able to train day in and day out. There always has to be pocket tournaments for us to gauge ourselves versus our competitors, not just here in the Philippines, but abroad as well, so that we can gauge ourselves against international teams. If there were times wherein some foreign teams would come into Manila to play against us, so if we have that opportunity, that would be good. But then, for the women's national team, we really need to be able to be consistent with the training. Dapat talaga walang dead time, because if we actually ask the other national teams, that's their life. That's all they do. They have training all throughout the year, and they have tournaments that they join all the time. So yeah.
Yeah, I mentioned about the SEA Games last year. That has long been a goal for the women's team to win that. What was it like in that championship game? It's right there. Talk us through a little bit about that experience for you, and what was it like for you, for the team, especially for the girls who've been there from, like, you know, from years and years of, like, hard work training and not getting it and then finally getting it. Talk us through a little bit about that experience.
Yeah, it was bittersweet for me because I really wanted to watch them live, but I couldn't. I was just watching them on TV. But, you know, coming into the SEA Games, I really had a big feeling that, you know, this is it. Everything that we went through, all the tournaments that the team joined, was leading to this gold for us. And the dynamics of the team was so good. You could really see how well the coaches planned all our trainings, all, you know, the game tactics that were needed to be done. And I'm just so happy that finally we were really able to get it, because yung managers namin, even them, they would always give us motivational speeches na this is it, this is finally it. And I think it paved the way to, you know, us having the professional league also now.
Yeah, finally.
Things are really just finally going into place, and I'm just happy that, you know, this is our time for women's basketball.
Yeah. Just a quick question on your national team experience again. Looking back, so far, who were the toughest players or teams or places that you've played in as part of the Philippine team?
So, well, in Southeast Asia, we've already proven that we are the best in Southeast Asia. But when we played in India for FIBA Asia, you can really see that, you know, we're still a bit behind. There's still a lot of growth and development that needs to be done. When you go up against China and you go up against Australia, their level of play is really different. You can see how cohesive their team is. You can see how they just know each other so well already. And aside from that, I really can't take away the fact that physically, in terms of height palang and size, medyo dehado na talaga tayo. But aside from that, I do believe that there are things that we can work on to be able to be competitive with them, which is our outside shooting. If we have a killer outside shooting, that was what made us win against India in the FIBA Asia. So if we can tap on that and enhance our outside shooting, if everyone can shoot from the outside, be it from 1 to 5, then we actually have a big chance also.
Right. Cool. Any thoughts on Jack playing in, I think, Taiwan?
Yes. Yeah.
How do you think she'll do over there?
Yeah, I think she'll really do well there. Yeah? We went to Taiwan last year for a training camp. So we actually, I'm not sure, I think we met the team that she was, that she's planning to play with in a few months, I guess, this year. So, you know, Jack Animam, her personality, her work ethic, her talent, wala ka talagang masasabi. And I just wish her all the best. She deserves everything that she has now, because she's really worked so hard to get to where she is. And I'm just really happy for all the opportunities that are coming into her.
All right. Dave, you want to talk about Bea's media experience?
Yeah. One of the things that we wanted to get your thoughts on, Bea, is your time at SNA. I'm on the record on the show saying that you were one of the analysts that I enjoy listening to doing the UAP basketball games. kind of reminds me of how, I'm not sure if you watch NFL, the National Football League, kind of reminds me how Tony Romo changed the, I guess, the way games are being called, because he would talk about, you know, what's coming in the next play, what the adjustments are about to happen, and then it turns out to be what actually happens. So I kind of see shades of that in what you're doing as a, as an analyst. Can you, I guess, for some of our viewers, listeners who are interested, how did you get into the media side of things, and I guess what preparation did you have to go through to get you ready to be as good as you are in what you're doing behind the camera, or I guess in front of the camera?
Yeah, so interestingly enough, my sports analyst role was not something that I ever really aspired for. So it started back when I was an upfront host for upfront at the UAAP, and then they asked me to be an analyst for the UAAP women's finals. And then I was thinking, okay, maybe I can do that because I know all the players. I went up against all of them, so I could do that. So I was like, okay, so when I did it, it was actually easy for me because I had so much background information about almost every player kasi nakalaban ko nga sila. And then I remember the director of the UAAP would joke to me all the time, oh, next year, Bea, sa men's ka naman. And then I would always be like, Direk, ano ka ba? Hindi ko kaya yan. Okay lang yan. Okay na ako dito sa women's. But then he would always be so insistent. And I never thought that it would actually come through. All, merely because, you know, there's never really a girl in women, in men's basketball or in the panel, so to speak. And I was really scared. So many thoughts were going into my mind. Because number one, I'm a very shy person, even if it doesn't look like it so much. But I'm a very shy person. I'm a very shy person. Especially when I was much younger, I was very scared about what people would think of me. I was very scared about what people would think of a female analyst, for that matter, being heard. Na babae yung naririnig nila watching a men's basketball game. I was scared of the backlash that I would receive. I would be like, baka, maybe I'm just not the right person to be that one, to be the women, the first female analyst. But at the end of the day, you know, as cliche as it may sound, I really needed to think of it more than just me. The way I thought of it, the thought process that I had for me to say yes to it was that this is like a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity, and I could just think of what can happen if I said yes, and what more opportunities can open up, not just for me, but for women's basketball. And maybe this is a sign that, you know, I could still have basketball in my life, but just in an analyst sense na lang. So I said yes, and in my first season, I think I was very, very shaky, very nervous still. But I'm just so happy with the trust that the UAAP management and ABS-CBN had in me. Because they would just be like, hindi, okay lang yan. Sige, ituloy mo lang. Kaya mo yan. Just be comfortable. You'll get it. Kasi tama naman yung sinasabi mo. Kailangan lang ng confidence with the way you say it. So I was just like, okay. I know this. I can do this. So I really studied, like, every game that I would cover, I would spend like sleepless nights like watching film of the teams that are gonna play, so that I know, you know, the tendencies of this player, of this team. Para alam ko ano sasabihin ko. So yeah, and then eventually, you know, I got the hang of it, but you know, still every game is still a learning experience. You still have things to improve on, but I'm happy that I'm a little bit more comfortable now already.
All right. Thank you for that, Bea. I think see, Tito Jeff is not shy. He has a question.
Thank you, Tito Dave. Bea, my question is, actually, this is just more of a curious question. I read in an ABS-CBN article that you mentioned that you had the dream of courtside reporting. Is this
yes.
correct?
Okay, so my dream of being a courtside reporter, it was just like something that I would think of. Na parang before, because I would always watch basketball, remember? So I would be like, oh, what if I would be a courtside reporter? I would always tell my mom that. But it was never really something that I would do. So it was just like a silent dream of mine. So I really never thought that it would actually happen. Because in the ABL, the ASEAN Basketball League, I was actually given an opportunity to become a courtside reporter. So I don't know. I guess everything fell into place, no? After saying yes to being an analyst for the UAAP, I was able to become an analyst for UAAP juniors as well, for the ABL, and even become an analyst for the ABL, even travel around the world because of the ABL. So I'm just so happy that I said that super big yes. And once I put that foot inside the door, it opened so many others.
Thank you for that, Abea. Speaking of preparation, the one that you mentioned a while ago, you studied tape for the players. I'm also curious, do you also talk to players as part of your research with them, like to know their background?
Yes, I do. So at the start, I really didn't know how to prepare. Just because like when I would ask some other analysts, some other anchors, you know, everyone has their own way of preparing. Some medyo kabisado na nila, so they don't need to put in as much effort as I do, maybe, just because I was just starting and I needed to get to know every single player, not just the first five, but also those who are in the bench, because you don't know who are going to be fielded in, right? So as a newbie, as a rookie, I needed to work extra hard for that. So yeah.
That's great. I have one last question, actually, with regard to sportscasting. I'm curious with regard to your sportscasting chemistry with your partner in the booth. Because I suppose you have different partners to switch in commentating, right?
Yes.
So I'm curious, how do you adjust with their different play-by-play styles? Like, if you can cite an example, like Nico Halili, commentates this way, while let's say Anton Rojas commentates this way. How do you adjust?
How do I adjust? Sige, maybe I don't. Ano ba? All the anchors, kasi sobrang galing talaga nila. And you know, sina Mico Halili, Boom Gonzalez, Nico Ramos, and everyone else. You know, they're well versed already in the industry, so they're people I look up to. And to be honest, they're really one of the reasons why I became comfortable, because they're the anchors. Sila talaga yung nagdadala. We're just the ones who talk after they talk, trying to explain what happened in the game. And Boom Gonzalez, I remember watching him when I was still young, no? He's one of the people who was really my mentors, including Tito Mico Halili, who would really tell me, who would really give me pointers. Even during timeouts, I'd be like, okay, Bea, you're doing fine. Just slow down a bit. You're talking a bit too fast. So I'm really thankful for them, because it's because of them that made me better in every game and make me more comfortable. Because it's so easy to be intimidated by them, because I really was. I really was. And it was a bit scary for me, but at the same time, they were also the ones who allowed me to get out of my comfort zone and, you know, just be myself. Because there's no rules, eh? You just have to be yourself, and your personality will be heard by the viewers. And just be confident in what you're saying. Kasi, feeling ko naman what I was telling myself before was that being knowledgeable about the game is something that I already have. So it's just the confidence to back that up. Because if I'm nervous, it would be obvious at the tone of my voice. And at the tone of my voice, people would hear it. And whenever I would watch my games after, I would actually notice how more comfortable I would be as the games passed by and with the more games that I covered. So I'm happy and thankful for my anchors for being there for me. Sina Tito Mico, sina Boom, yan.
All right. Thank you very much, Bea. Over to you, Dave.
Thank you for that, Bea. I'm curious to find out how you handled the cotton mouth when you were starting out as a part of the EBS-EBN broadcast crew. Did you do anything differently? I guess not in terms of preparation for the game, but how did you mentally, I guess, adjust to the nerves, so to speak? Is it the same routine you had when you were playing, or is it different?
I think it's the same in terms of preparation. Because I really feel that preparation is key, not just for games, but for anything. The preparation that I put in being an analyst gave me confidence. So if, for example, I wasn't able to watch one full game or finish the whole game of a particular team that I was going to cover, I wouldn't feel as confident as if I prepared like days before. So that's what I really believe in. Preparation is key. Sometimes I would get intimidated because some of my partners sometimes wouldn't need any código or anything. They would, it's like they had their memory in their brains already. Alam na nilang lahat. But for me, I really wanted to write down all the statistics of each players and everything. But in my mind, I was always like, do you. Just do you. And for as long as it works, and it worked for me, everything's, I guess, turned out to be okay.
Right. That's I guess that's something to keep in mind when there are, I guess, new things we want to try out, and we're unsure whether to go or not.
Yeah, pero speaking, in the first few games, ha, since sobrang nanginginig talaga ako, and I could feel it in my voice. I'm like, shocked, ayoko na. There was a time nga na parang, shocked, ayoko na mag-cover. Parang, pwede bang mag-weekend na lang ako? Wala nang game. Kasi sobrang kinakabahan talaga ako. And I watch basketball. So, when I watch myself, sometimes I'd be like, ang pangit talaga eh. But I guess that's what pushed me to become better. Because I was my own critic. Because I watched the game so much. And I would know if I was doing better or not because I was a fan of the game. And I guess my never say die attitude and personality just wanted myself to prove, not to others, but to myself that I could do it. So I'm happy that ABS-CBN just right before their franchise was canceled, gave me the opportunity to, you know, be an analyst for the UAE.
Yeah, speaking actually of coverage and the franchise rights, covering sports. One thing that we try to do in the show is get our guests' thoughts and take on the coverage that the women's side of things get. Growing up, you mentioned you watched a lot of hoops, and was there any time that you were wondering why there wasn't a lot of women's games on TV, or did you not care? Did you just, you know, I want to watch basketball. I'm not going to try to find what isn't there. I'm just going to watch what is on TV.
Uh-huh. Well, I guess before, I felt like it was just the norm, that it was just men's basketball playing on TV. But as I got older, that's when I realized that, you know, hey, there are so many female ballers that are so good, extremely talented. I really want us to be known more, especially when I was started covering the women's UAAP finals. That is when I really was wondering, like, why not showcase more semifinals, elimination round as well. So yeah, I guess when I was in college, that's really when I wanted women's basketball to be more known, because that's when I realized more about the disparity of men's basketball and women's basketball. So I'm just happy that now, slowly but surely, we're getting the attention and the support that we've all been wanting.
Yeah, that's as you mentioned, it's quite unfortunate that the one, I think, media entity that puts a premium on the girls' game has been taken off air. Yeah. especially now when they just started doing the girls basketball, even the high school side.
Yeah.
They've already started as initial run last season. Where do you think or what factors or what events do you think need to happen to sort of catalyze more coverage, more demand for the women's game? Because it's something that is often discussed on this show. What comes first? Is it the demand, or do you have to start with the supply side of things? What's your opinion coming from both on the player side and the also on the media side?
Well, I was actually talking to the commissioner of the WNBL earlier, and she was saying that there's a surplus of female ballers all over the Philippines, but then they're just not tapped. So I think in terms of supply, the talent is there, the number of players are there. I think that what's lacking is really the support. So the support has to be a 360-degree support. So it's not just putting up the professional league. Aside from the professional league, there needs to be a grassroots program that really develops these players so that people can aspire to become better basketball players. Because the youth need to be able to aspire to become basketball players so that there's a next generation of female ballers again. So just like there is a grassroots program and a complete program for men's basketball, it has to be the same for female basketball. So, yeah.
All right. Thanks for that, Bea. The professional league, I think, is a long way coming through, and hopefully magtuloy-tuloy. I think that the momentum is there. There's a lot of challenges, including the pandemic and the media side of it. Nabawasan yung potential competitors who will produce the shows, but I think it's on the right track. We're a bit closer, I guess, to the conclusion of the show, Bea. But before we get into that, you talked about your favorite basketball players earlier. So what I would do now is instead get your thoughts on who do you think are the up-and-comers you think might be future superstars in the game. Who do you have your eye on that you're saying this might be a kid that's worth watching in 2 or 3 years?
In the men's scene, UAP?
Any women's, high school. Whoever you have in mind right now, even the NBA, if you want to go that way.
Maybe in the female ballers side first. I would have to say Camille Clarin. So she's a Phil Canadian player. She's, I think, one of the endorsers.
She's with NU, right?
Yes, she's one of the endorsers of Nike and Titan, if I'm not mistaken. But that girl, she's part of the 3-on-3 under 18. They're already, I think they won bronze in the FIBA already. She's a champion player, part of the national university. She played in Canada, she played in the States, and now she's bringing her talent here. She's a really tall girl, around like 5'9", 5'8", maybe. Can shoot from the outside. Has a really great personality, really wants to be able to improve her game. I think she's the next face of the UAAP after the exit of Jack Animam. I think she'll be the next star. In terms of men's basketball, I'd have to say Abando, Mark Nonoy. For UP, still the GDL brothers. I know that one of them will be, one GDL will be taking his leave first, maybe this year or maybe next year too, I'm not sure, but definitely them. In the NBA, I really love Damian Lillard. I really love the way he plays. So I'm a sucker for all point guards since I'm a point guard myself. So I love watching him play there.
Mike?
I have two questions. First one is, when will NU lose, and who do you think is gonna break the streak?
Oh my gosh, that's also my question.
I think that's everyone's question.
You know, NU, their winning streak is super deeply embedded in the culture that they have, and I think that because it's embedded so much in their culture, like every single player that they get, even if, for example, she's not a star or anything, she's able to blend in so seamlessly into their team, into their culture, into their style of play. And even with the likes of Afril Bernardino, Jack Animam already graduating, I still think they're a formidable team that can still get on a winning streak. But not to count out all the other teams, I think that with NU rising and continuing their winning streak, other teams are also being more competitive and, you know, trying to beef up their rosters. Like, for example, USD already got an import. I know LaSalle is also coming in with an import as well. Ateneo gets Phil and players also. So even UP is actually going to get an import maybe next year or in 2 years from now. So hopefully, you know, I don't want to, ang hirap naman sana they lose, no? Hindi naman ganun. But then I'm just happy, you know, that with the winning streak of NU, it really forces all other teams to be as competitive as they are. And it's great to see that, you know, they're really doing all means to be able to improve and, you know, heighten their level of play.
Right. And then my other question was, you're a point guard. Who did you model your game after growing up?
Well, growing up, as I mentioned, I really loved watching the PBA. So I really loved watching Jason Castro and Jimmy Alabang. Yeah. They're really my two, as in favorite idols. So I don't know if I patterned my game with them because ang gagaling nila. But then they're really the ones who I looked up to growing up.
All national team point guards, including you. So I think you you patterned, or you know, you watched the correct players growing up. I guess. Dave, you want to take it?
Yeah, we have a segment here on the show, Bea. We call five questions. I guess as the name implies, we're gonna make you choose three questions, one question at a time. I hope you can see Mike's screen right now.
Yeah.
Mike, why don't you go to the next slide so Bea can choose any of the five questions, and then which number do you want to go with first, Bea?
Ayan, number one na lang.
Sige. What if you can read the question for us?
Okay, so if you were stuck in an island with which three players or coaches or celebrities would you want to be with you and why? Maybe players, maybe Danica Jose, because she's one of my best friends in basketball. Celebrities. Sino ba? Celebrities. Wala akong maisip. Captain Ri. I'm not sure, but I watch Korean novella. Sorry. And then, sino pa ba? Si Danica Jose. And Jack Animam. Only because Jack Animam, you know, she's really so lovable. And she's so hyper and always positive, so you'll never have adult time with Jack and Mom there.
All right. Thankfully, Danica will be one of our next guests, so we're looking forward to that one as well. Yeah. Which is your second choice, second pick, Bea?
Number two. Okay. If your life were made to be into a movie, which actors would be in it and why? Kung Pinoy, sino ba? Si John Lloyd Cruz and si Bea Alonzo. Ano ba? Madrama siguro yung buhay ko. Hindi ko alam. Pero yun. And maybe Sarah Geronimo to put in some comedic relief. But yeah, I think I've gone through so much ups and downs and everything, but at the end of the day, I still want to be positive and still be happy and enjoy life. So yeah.
All right, thank you for that, Bea. What about your last pick?
Number 3.
All right.
Ooh, hold on. I can't see the. Number. If you can change anything in the UAAP today, what would it be and why? Maybe I just change the coverage of women's basketball. I really want it to be more televised, starting with the elimination round up until to the finals. Because I do know that, you know, men's basketball players are more explosive, more athletic than we are. But watching female basketball, it's a different form of entertainment. You really see the fundamentals of everyone, and it's still very enjoyable to watch. Because sobrang iba siya from men's basketball na sobrang explosive, yung talagang airtime and all, nagda-dunk and all. But if you really just give us a chance to be able to showcase what we can do, I think that a lot of people can really fall in love with watching female ballers as well. So yeah.
I personally think that female ballers are more fundamentally skilled than men's ballers.
Yeah, si Mike kasi showboat lang si yeah. Mike maglaro. Okay.
Flashy ba flashy?
flashy and on and off the court. So that's how he rolls. Yeah. All right. Bea, we're nearing the conclusion of the show. One thing that we do want to get your thoughts on this. How do you see yourself in the next 5-10 years? Assuming we do another episode of Game Time in 10 years, what do you think, or what are the, I would say, highlights or milestones that hopefully you would have achieved looking back to 2020 and beyond?
Yeah. Well, on a basketball side, I really don't want to leave basketball. I know that I'm a mom now, and maybe 5 or 10 years from now, I'll have maybe 1 or 2 more kids. But I don't want basketball to ever leave my side. And with that said, I feel that my connection with basketball would stay as an analyst. Hopefully that I can continue becoming an analyst of the game, because I really enjoy doing that. And whether it's me being a coach, or whether it's me, you know, trying to put up a league, or maybe helping a team or anything like that, anything that I can do actually to help women's basketball, I want to be able to do that, because basketball has been a part of me all my life. And just because I have a kid, just because I'm married, doesn't mean that it can stop. So even if I'll stop playing basketball in a few years, it doesn't mean that it ends there. So hopefully there's always an avenue for me to stay in touch with the game.
All right. Before I go into my last question, Mike, Jeff, you have anything to ask Bea?
I'm okay, man. But just wanna thank Bea for her time. But yeah, go ahead, Dave.
Yeah, no, I just had two more questions for you, Bea. One is obviously coming from a place of ignorance. I'm just curious. You're a mom now. How do you think, or how more difficult do you think it would be for you to balance all the, demands placed on you as a mom, as a wife? You have a full-time job, and if you want to stay competitive, be part of the national team. How do you think, or how do you plan on, making it work?
You know, sometimes I always tell myself that, you know, when I was pregnant, I was always telling myself that when I give birth, this is it. I'm not going to play basketball and ever again. But, you know, my baby's already 3 months old. The Women's National Basketball League will be a professional league. And then something in me is like, oh, feeling ko kaya ko pa. One more time. Grabe yung drive ng basketball in me. Eh. Grabe yung passion talaga. Eh. Pag naiisip ko siya, namimiss ko kaagad. And I'm just thankful that I have a really good support system. My husband always tells me that, you know, if you still want to play, you can play. I will support you and everything. So, I guess time management is something that I mastered in college. And it is something that I will master once again. If I go back into playing, I will find the time to be able to juggle everything. And hopefully, I'll be able to do that. And once again, I think that I'll find the time to be able to play basketball. If kung gusto mo naman talaga, may paraan pa din. So, yeah.
I like that. Kung gusto, may paraan. My last question for you, Bea. You've done a lot as a student, as an athlete in the UAP. You've done media. You're probably doing the most important job in the world now as a mother. What keeps you going? What inspires Bea Daez Fabros?
Well, of course, now what keeps me going really is my kid, because I really want to be able to give her like the best life possible. But on a more personal note for me, what keeps me going, I really want to be the best version of myself in everything that I do, as in whether it's basketball or not. When I was part of the national team, I really wanted to be the best version of myself as a player, so that I can put out my potential there in the team. Now that there's a professional league, I want to be able to be the best player that I can be again, so that I can play competitively again maybe next year when I'm fully recovered after giving birth. So yeah, wanting to be the best version of myself and everything that I do really keeps me going and keeps me motivated to have like to set goals all the time. Whether it's short-term or long-term.
All right. Thank you for that, Bea. We will definitely be on the lookout for when you get back on the basketball court, if you so choose. We are fans, both on the camera side work that you do and on the basketball court. And we're looking forward to seeing more of you, in the game. And we're very thankful for the time that you've given us this lovely afternoon. Before we let you go, would you mind if Mike would take a screenshot so we can put this up on Mike's Instagram?
All right. That's
okay.
Yeah, cool.
Thank you, guys. Thank you.
Thank you so much,
Bea. Thank you very much, Bea.
Okay. Yeah, we had a lot of fun. And again, stay safe. And regards to the husband.
Yes.
And stay safe out there.
Thank you.
Thanks, Bea. Salam. More power.
Bye-bye. Thank you. And that's it, ladies and gentlemen. That was Bea Daez Fabros. That was a very good podcast with her. She was able to share her great career in both basketball and sportscasting. We applaud you, Bea, for being such a great achiever. Thank you. And for you listeners and viewers, please stay tuned to our next episode of Game Time. Peace out.